Glory, glory, glory. Praise Yah, saints of the Most High Yah. Let us rejoice and be glad. Rise, wake righteousness. Let us greet one another in the beauty of holiness. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're grateful for another holy Shabbat. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you. And Elohim spoke all these words, saying, I am Yahweh your Elohim, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of slavery. You have no other mighty ones against my face. You do not make for yourself a carved image, or any likeness of that which is in the heavens above, or which is in the earth beneath, or which is in the waters under the earth. You do not bow down to them, nor serve them, for I, Yahweh your Elohim, am a jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth of those who hate me, but showing love and commitment to the thousands of those who love me and guard my commands. You do not bring the name of Yahweh your Elohim to naught, for Yahweh does not leave an unpunished who brings his name to naught. Remember the Shabbat to set it apart. 6 days you labor and should do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath, to Yahweh your Elohim. In it you do not do any work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male slave, nor your female slave, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days Yah made heaven and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore Yah blessed the Sabbath day and set it apart. Respect your father and your mother, so that your days are prolonged upon the soil which Yahweh your Elohim has given you. You do not murder, you do not commit adultery, you do not steal, you do not bear false witness against your neighbor, you do not cover a neighbor's house, you do not cover a neighbor's wife, nor his male slave, nor his female slave, nor his ox, nor his donkey, whatsoever belongs to your neighbors.
Hallelujah. Abba Yahweh, we bless your magnificent, wonderful name. We thank you for Yahshua. We thank you for the sacrifice, the blood atonement, reconciling us. And back again to you in right ruling and standing. We need the Ruach to minister to us here this morning, to let these sins sink deep down in our hearts that the Mavis have spoke to us in past times. We thank you for all the apostles, all the prophets, all the holy men that's been on before us. We can only hope to walk even a quarter in the step of holiness and righteousness that they have. We thank you because of the blood. We thank you for all things. We need the Ruach to minister. Talk to us here this morning. Give us an understanding so that we can be a light unto the goyims in this world, to draw all men unto you in the magnificent name of Yahshua HaMashiach. Amen. You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
Glory to the King.
Glory.
All right. Well, here we are again, huh? I know we're in Shabbat service. Sometime I guess you can call this protest service, huh? I mean, usually, you know, I mean, come on, man. Usually at times, you know, people don't mind if you have religious disobedience. People practice civil disobedience, don't they? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's good seeing all y'all. Y'all encouraged?
Yes, sir.
You should be. We greet all of y'all on the other side of that camera out there that are viewing us by way of the highway, the internet highway.
Yes, sir.
And those of you who are outside the corners of the United States of Satan's authority, America. You know USA means under Satan's authority, right?
Yes, sir.
Oh, come on now. Don't be sitting there trying to act patriotic on me. Now you need to know what you're into.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Stop with these fairy tales and deceptions that you've all believed in. You know you're believing in nothing but lies from the day you were born. And then when the truth came to you, the first thing you did was start contending against it. As if you were right. You walk around with two left mouths, two left feet. Think about it for a second. It should be an insult. But it's a systematic disorder. The whole world is under the control of the wicked one, with exceptions of the ones that have the Ruach in them, if you understand what I mean. Now, I'm going to try, because the phone calls and the letters that we receive this week is showing that there are a lot of brand new, even though you may be old, like Elder Doug back there. All right, must be a lot of brand new people, at least new and conscious, that are listening. So I'm going to try my best not to confuse you with a lot of Hebraic terms and words and stuff. I'll use them interchangeably to try to make sure that you can grasp and understand the word in the hour that we're in, because of if anything we need in this hour is understanding, or let me say comprehension. We need to be able to comprehend, okay, because I don't want you to stand under nobody's authority but the Most High Yah. Does that make sense? So I may sound strange, but I assure you that I may sound ignorant. I may sound foolish. I may sound dumb, but I am not without knowledge. Hallelujah. You're not going to meet too many ministries that actually has a considerable amount of the portions of Yahshua working. People love being religious. I mean, the scribes and Pharisees was religious, right? They walked around in long robes. Love being called rabbi. Yeah. Rabbi. Huh? They did. Only one problem, though. They didn't have no power. As a matter of fact, they said amongst themselves, they said, what are we going to do about this Mashiach right here? Oh, Messiah. What are we going to do about him? Because he doeth many good works. What do we? I'll tell you what we do. Walk around like whited sepulchers. That's what you do. You look holy. You understand what I mean? That's what you do. And that's the same thing people are doing today. It's having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And of course, what does the instruction teach us from such? Turn away. Turn away. In other words, get them out of your life, because they're not going to benefit you whatsoever at all. Hallelujah. That's what the book teaches. Hallelujah. So we believe in healing the sick, raising the dead, casting out devils, all that. And not only do we believe it, but have done it. That's another thing to put mental assent with, but it's another thing when you have walked in it and done it. And to this world, it's a foreign concept, especially over here in the Western Hemisphere, where people are religious. You know, all you have to do is look like a mockingbird. You can become a preacher on TBN. And people are always wondering, they ask me, why and where? I had somebody just this morning ask me, why do I attack Christianity so much? I said, you asking me why? Yo, are you serious? See, that is somebody who has been trained and not educated. That's someone who has never used an ounce of self-autonomy. None whatsoever at all. That is someone who have believed every single thing that they have been told, and have not done their own due diligence to investigate anything. I know you love your mom and daddy, but your mom and daddy are liars. You don't believe me? Let's do a checklist real quick. Huh? If you ever believe in a big old fat man that's going to come and rob somebody's house, break in. You ever believe a big old fat man going to break in? How in the world did breaking in? Coming down a chimney. We got a lot of stoves around here, but I don't understand how this big old man can get down a 6-inch stovepipe. But he does it. He can break into your house every year and you leave milk and cookies out for him. And on top of your roof, even if you don't have one, there's a sled and a bunch of deers. One of them got a red nose. Now we see deer almost every morning out here, and I've yet to see one take flight. You should be ashamed of yourself. Literally, you should. I didn't teach my children them fairy tales. No, I didn't. And my children are 28 and 25. They can tell you I have never taught them fairy tales. Even as a heathen, when they were very, very young, even when we came to the faith very young, I never taught them fairy tales. I didn't want them to lie to me, so I wasn't going to lie to them. That don't make me some type of great perfect man or nothing like that. It's just that what I expected out of them, I expected of myself first. Is there something wrong with that? Huh? Anybody ever seen a rabbit laying eggs? I ain't never seen a rabbit laying eggs. And we kill all kind of rabbits around here. Now, most of you would get upset because we shoot the rabbit and throw it over in the woods. Most of you be like, well, shucks, that's the greatest survival food since mankind, man. What you doing wasting all that good meat? That little booger's unclean. And I can't stand it when I see Bugs Bunny over there in my lettuce and munching on my beans. I got some heat for him. And I fire him up real good, too. Yeah, I do, too. I put some heat on him. Brother Scott one morning heard me using that AR. Boom! He like, hold, pass down. Hey, I got a Ruger 10-22. You can use that one. Because, man, I tell you, man, I was blasting them from here until the body parts are just splattering. Guts hanging out all over the place. He said, you can do it. I know I can do a job with the 22. You know what I mean. But that's all I had at my disposal at that time. I was grabbing the first thing my hand could get a hold of. And every year they celebrate Easter. The Lord's Passover. That's what they say, the Lord. And at the greatest meat in the meal is ham. Pig. Oink. Oink. You cannot be more abominable than that. You know, the apocrypha tell you that that swine is going to be used in part of the abomination that make a desolate. What you people going to do now that pork prices is now giving beef prices a run for his money? He's still going to pay for it, isn't he? What troubles me more than anything is all these Israelites that have consented to the laws of the land and still fight for a bacon sandwich. Did you know that the Most High said, now, hey, it makes no difference, totally irrelevant whether you believe it or not. It matters what he said. And this did make it down through the gauntlet of penmanship to get us to this point right here. And it still states in there, go ahead and eat all the swine you want. You're going to go to hell. That's the short version of it. Now be saved, be sanctified, be filled with the Holy Spirit, be all of that you want. Keep the commandments, do everything. And go ahead and still eat that swine and see where you end up at. And Yah cannot lie. All throughout the book it teaches us against lawlessness, whoring, servants of other mighty ones, other gods. It always does. Don't it? And we have assimilated so much in the culture that we don't even get offended no more. But there's only one solution. Come out of her, my people. Because if you don't come out, you're going to continue to keep the same mindset. Nothing is going to change. None. I had some fellow brethren after the flesh. You ever heard of New Testament talking like that before? They asked me, they this is the comment they asked me, because see, they make little pleas now. Because after they've checked out the ministry and stuff, they finally have come to the conclusion, I better leave this man alone. Because every time we start going over and attacking him, our people go and investigate, and next thing you know, they over there, and now they part of Straightway. Glory. So they don't say too much about it. And he noticed, you know, we got that picture up there that Brother D. Jerry drew of myself, Pastor Fox, and Pastor Corey, right? And the first thing they do is start saying, well, who is that Esau up there? And I'm like, I don't see no Esau up there. I said, I'm more concerned about Esau on the other side of this keyboard. Because they know what I'm playing, right? I said, how in the world can that man be Esau when he's living a set-apart life and obeying the commandments? And you, sitting up there, still got your rear end stuck in them cities. There's going to be a weep and a howl. Come all through this land. You know, warning always come before destruction.
And that's the reason why the Most High Yah often had his Naveens or his prophets continually warn the people, because he's merciful. He is merciful and he's benevolent. That's what he is. He's not willing that any should perish, that everyone come to obedience, come to the truth. But we are a hard-headed, gainsaying people. Now, that ain't you. That's the person next to you, right? Turn to your left and say, you hard-headed. That ain't hard to do, is it? Now, look at yourself. And turn to your right and say, you equally hard-headed. Now, when you start putting that mirror in front of you, you getting it? Now, you've got the revelation. You got the revelation now. Now you have crossed over. Oh, hallelujah. Y'all doing all right?
Yes, sir.
All right, we're not going to be long, be the Father's will before we're going to get on with it. You know, we as a people are the last basking of holiness that is left in this generation. I started off in an apostolic holiness commandment-keeping church. And I know that's odd. That's very odd when you go back 20-something years, 25, 26 years ago. That's very odd. Can you imagine that when the Father had me fill the Ruah, I'm inside of a Sabbath-keeping, commandment-keeping, clean food-eating, Passover-taking? That is unheard of, isn't it? Unheard of in this world. Because Satan, under the religion of Christianity, I just tore down two of them in Christianity, didn't I? And then the last one, sun worship. You don't believe they sun worship? Look at the marquee on their churches. It'll tell you, sun worship. You going to believe what you read? That's what it says, sun worship. I wonder why Christ didn't go to assembly on Sunday or first day. That's good, isn't it? He didn't do it. Now, all that was for you people out there. You recover yourself real fast. Don't go tearing up computers like a lot of people do. Y'all know people grab a hold of their computers, especially they got spouses that get enraged. I'm telling you, we've had people come in and say, my wife grabbed that computer monitor and slammed it. She pulled it out of the wall and slammed it and said, I ain't listening to this no more. I said, why don't you just cast the devil out? Naturally or spiritually. Amen. Either way, get out.
That's right.
If I work and pay $200 or $300 for a monitor, my wife get a spirit on her, she gonna go.
Amen.
Tearing up property.
Right.
All because you got a spirit on you.
Yeah.
You don't do nothing but cause a greater. We're already out of debt. We're not trying to go back in debt. People do that. Bro, how they do that, man? I mean, people get raw. They get raw. They used to, way, like in the late 90s and early 2000s, I used to have family members. They family members used to try to, because, you know, shortwave radio is not like AM, FM. Shortwave radio, you got to put long wires and everything else. You got time antennas. And you got to stand just right to get the signal in. And that's when I was broadcasting on WWCR. And WRMB, you know what I mean? I was, and people would hear that, and they would listen. I had people tearing up shortwave radios. Their spouse be out on the deck or somewhere in the house, and they take these night. We used to get nice, expensive shortwave radios too. Ones that had a cassette in it too that you can push down. You can record as you hear it. They take them thing. Them thing $200-$300. Bam! Smash them. But you know what? If I lied to you, everybody be all right. Wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? Huh? If I put some secular music on, it won't cause one bit of offense whatsoever at all. Mm-mm. Won't trouble nobody. Huh? You could hate country and put on Johnny Cash and it still wouldn't cause that kind of a spirit. Wouldn't cause that kind of spirit at all. But see, that lets you know how spiritual this word is. There's not a person in this world that can say I've done them wrong. Now, if it is, please come forward. Now, I'm sure I've probably done somebody wrong. You're going to do somebody wrong in this world. But if I've done it wrong, can I have an opportunity to make it right? At least afford me that opportunity. Is that all right? Oh, mercy. Huh. But Christianity is the strong delusion that the Bible speaks about in the book of Thessalonians, the letters that the apostle Paul or Saul wrote to the assembly at Thessalonica. And we all been influenced by it. And we all still got some of the residue of that mindset on us. Hallelujah. It's a shame too. Come out of her, my people. That is the message of the hour. Not only is it the message of the hour today, but it was the message of the hour in the prophet's time too. Hallelujah. I keep telling you that the renewed covenant is nothing but an echo of what has already been written. They can't add to or take it away. They knew that. They knew the rules. It's the way that people misrepresent the emissaries and what they have said. All right, on to perfection, Israel. On to perfection. Now, we know what the words in Abarim says, but look at that. I found this morning. I said, isn't that true? I'd rather be hated for speaking Yah's truth than held for trying to redefine it. And boy, I tell you, I'm a hated man. Y'all know y'all pastor hated man? Yeah, y'all know that? And then ask them why they hate me. You're going to come up with crickets. You hear a bunch of noise, but to ask them why they hate me. That's too much control when somebody have that kind of, you know, can make you that angry. That's a lot of control. I wonder if I should tack on puppet master to the end of my name and then put for the angry folks. Because anytime I want, I can disturb you. All I got to do is tell the truth. Hebrews 6:1. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundations of repentance. Not laying again the what? The foundations of repentance from dead works and faith towards Yah. Of the doctrine of what? Baptisms, laying on of hands, and of the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we would do if Yah permit. For it is impossible for those who are once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of Yah and the powers of the world to come, if they shall what? If they shall fall away, to renew them again. Notice key word. If they shall fall away, to renew them again unto what? That's the first order of the first principles is repentance. Because repentance is the doorway. It is the way you enter in at the door in order to have a right relationship with the Father. All right? Watch this. Seeing that they have crucified themselves, the Son of Yah afresh, and have put him to a what? Open shame. That simply means that there was a period of time that you had walked in the commandments. You had walked in the laws and statutes. You repented, allegedly, so-called, for your sins, iniquity, and transgressions. And then something happened, and you fell away from these first principles. And when you fell away, the hypocritical mockers that were out there in the world said, we knew that you wasn't in anything. And it puts a bitter taste in their mouth because there ain't no way they can take this thing serious since you didn't take it serious. And so therefore, what you have done is you are putting the Son of Yah afresh and put him to an open shame by your weak testimony. Hear that? Renew under repentance, put him to an open shame. Y'all get that? Huh? Renew unto repentance, put him to an open shame. The six principles of the Hebrew faith are repentance, faith in Yahweh, and that's not mental sin. Faith is best demonstrated by what you do. Baptisms, there's the baptism water, immersion, and then there's the spiritual baptism of the Holy Spirit, or the Ruach. Laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead. eternal judgment. These are the basic principles of Israelites to the doctrine of Hamashiach or Christ. Hamashiach the Messiah. Now, Yohanan 8:31, we're going to do a lot of reading from the scriptures version today. So if you're not familiar with it, just go to the King James Version. It will read somewhat, but not quite. But this will give you a more concrete meaning, a better understanding, all right? So Yohanan or John 8:31. So Yahshua said to those Yehudims who believe in him, if you stay in my word, that's a big key right there. Notice, if you do what? If you do what? Now we can see the reason why we heard these particular quotes right here. If you endure to the end. Endure. Because you people need to understand, Satan don't care what he has to use to knock you off course, to get you out of the faith. He don't care. It could be something as simple as a lying preacher. Amen. A rebellious spouse. Huh? Somebody could offend you. Oh, it could be envy and jealousy that you can't overcome. He don't care. He's playing hardball. Whatever it could take to get you from doing this nonsense you're doing right now. Obeying the commandments, that's his point of view and perspective. I think it's righteousness.
Come on.
All right? He's going to use it to get you out of it.
Yes, sir.
And all he needs is just one little offense. What are you offended at?
Right.
And who are you offended by?
Yes, sir. Right. Amen. Preach. Amen.
What? You need to know?
Yes, sir.
Because those people walk this thing 20 years, and then you can see them the next day, and it looks like they ain't never been in this thing before in their life. And don't you ever try to go and speak to them about the word since they have 20 years of walking in this. Because once Satan get a hold of them, they'll whip you up with that word. And become a greater devil than the devil himself. That's when you refuse to know your own heart's bitterness. How can somebody turn around and say, I don't believe in casting out devils, yet the Messiah do it and you see us do it, but you don't believe it? Who in the hell are you?
Yes, sir. Right. Amen. That's right. That's true.
People get to, man, I ain't never seen a casting out devil. Just come on to mass deliverance one time.
Yeah.
You ain't going to worry about seeing it. You won't believe how many come out of you.
Yeah.
Ain't that right?
Yes, sir.
But have we seen people, haven't we? Dig in. Hold on. They're going to insulate and protect them devils that's in them. Unbelief. Don't worry about it. The Father ain't going to waste his time trying to get past that. He got better things to do, like redeem his sanctified ones. Hallelujah. But check it out now. So Yahshua said to those Yehudims who believe in it, if you stay, that's what I want to put emphasis on. If you stay in my word, you are truly my taught ones. The King James says, you are my disciples. Indeed. All right? 1 Kings 15:5, I want you to see the attitude of King David. Because David did that which was right in the eyes of Yahweh and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only in the matter of Uriah the what? Now, you know what? Most people say, if you're an African, that's what they call it today. Uriah was a Canaanite. All right? Canaanites come from, around that geographical location. All right? I mean, because we often read all kind of indictments against the Canaanites, the Jebusites, the Hivites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Moabites. Isn't that right? Over and over and over again. All these nations that surround. Isn't that right? That's the geographical location, or the land of Ham. That's where they come from. And yet and still, he was in David's army.
Amen. Yep.
And Yah went back to the law and gave stripe for stripe.
Yes, sir.
An eye for an eye.
Yes, sir.
Life for life.
Yes, sir.
Two for two.
Yes,
didn't he?
Yes, sir.
And this is a man right up to Yah's own heart. Huh? He took his firstborn. Man went and took the man's wife. Because he was the king. You get that? Now, if this guy didn't receive so much honor, Uriah, why the Most High went ahead and make swift judgment then? I mean, after all, shouldn't he take, if we will use modern day terminology, the Africans and say, man, forget it, ain't no big deal. Y'all didn't play that mess. So even though he wasn't Hittite, man, he had to be an Israelite to be fighting in the armies too then, didn't he? You see, it's this backwards junk and mess and this. See, I'm telling you, the problem today is that the black folks has learned from the white man real well. They talk about racism, and now we doing it worse than they ever have.
Yes, sir.
We doing it worse than they ever have. Not all of us. You know, everybody ain't stupid like that.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Isn't that true?
It is.
That is true.
Yes,
Abraham, the father of faith, was married to Africans.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Did I say something wrong?
No, sir.
Moses, the custodian of the law, was married to Africans.
Yes,
I'm talking about Hamites.
Yes,
amen.
Somebody that wasn't the seed of Shem.
Amen.
And you people, boy, I think what I'm doing is recovering some of you people that's coming over here spying on our liberty.
Yes,
Zephaniah Paneth.
Yes,
come on now.
Yes,
yourself.
Yes,
went into the land of Ham and married a Hamite.
Yes,
yep.
Your eyes bigger than mine now, ain't they? Now, this ain't got nothing to do with today's message, but somebody must be out there spying again. You know, every time I go off like this, somebody out there chances are you're probably getting recovered. But, you know, it's in there. You got to bring emphasis on it since we have so much of this discrimination that's going on today. We got to make sense of this, right? Isn't that right? Huh? Now, according to the Torah, suppose all of us Hebrew warriors, right? We going to war. And we went up to the land of Japhet, and we saw a damsel there, a woman that was we were very fond of.
Amen.
Huh? Don't the law say that we could have her?
Yes,
what did it tell us we could do? We bring her home?
Yep.
Shave her head?
Yep.
Pair of nails?
Yes,
give her 30 days of mourn?
Right.
Then after that, you go into her, and she is your
wife.
Most, I didn't care what color she was.
Yeah.
Color came because of these Europeans in the 1600s by some German philosopher that started redefining everything Caucasoid, Mongoloid, and Negroid, and you can't spell none of them. It's just a sad situation. It really is. I'm for y'all. I am for y'all 100% plus nothing. Hallelujah. I am for Yah. Yohanna 15:5. John 15:5 from the scriptures. I am the vine. That's what the Messiah said, right? And you are the branches. That's what the Messiah said, right?
That's right.
Hallelujah. All right. He who stays. There, here we go again. Here we go again. What's that word right there?
Stay.
In me. That didn't mean you in 1 minute, out the next minute. You people that's in 1 minute, out the next minute, you ain't never had no real true conversion. You have never had an experience with the Most High. No. Uh-huh. How come I'm not in 1 minute, out the next minute? Huh? Come on. And I'm just a small thing. I'm not even nothing even worthy to even be compared to. I'm the least of all of it. And I in him, he bears much what? That's if you are in him. You bear much fruit. Because without me, you are able to do what? You can't do nothing. Now, y'all see that man right there? I've been what many of you have learned from Christianity, because a lot of people, they like taking credit for what the Messiah has done. Let's set this thing straight, okay? I am just a presenter of truth. Huh? A spokesperson and a mouthpiece of Yah.
Yes,
I am not Yah. No man on this earth is Yah.
Yes,
it is his truth that we're representing as ambassadors to the kingdom.
Yes,
we, through obedience, after we have been converted, we preach the word to you. It is his Ruah that got you. You heard his word being preached. Because he commanded us to speak his word.
Yes,
just like Moshe was a custodian of the law,
yes,
Moses don't get any credit.
Yes,
No, he don't. He gets credit for being a good prophet and a good obedient man of God. Huh? But all praise is due to the Most High. You understand that? So the problem today is that you got a lot of these preachers out there that people have set up as kings. Yeah, they have. Giving them more than what they should be honored for. Is that making sense? Are you following me? Now, we preached the word, but it was the word, his word, that was around well before we were, that went into your ears, went deep down in your heart, and that was his ruah that convicted you. And the voice you heard wasn't the voice of the preaching that you heard. The preaching was just a means to facilitate the word to put it inside of you. That word was deposited inside of you. And then when it got down inside of you, it awake the person who it was there to receive it for. For it was there for. Do you understand? So his word got in touch with your spirit that was dead in his trespasses, in his iniquities. You wasn't seeking Yah. You weren't thinking about Yah. It was him that was thinking about you. You were lost and undone. You were on Yah or his side. You didn't do nothing but make a mess of things. So Christ didn't say the day, Christ didn't say the day you hear Pastor Dial's voice, harden not your heart. He didn't say the day that you hear the Apostle Paul's words, harden not your heart. He didn't say the day you hear Moses, harden not your heart. He said the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. That's what he said. So get it right. Because you know how you do if you're just a servant of men, right? You'll be bitter, envious, jealous. You want to start wars and fightings, everything else. But when you realize it was him that the one that redeemed you, maybe your attitude will change a little bit. Maybe be adjusted just a little bit. Maybe you'll start showing some respect and honor for the reward that was given for you. Just maybe. So let's get it right. It is his word. We are helpers to your faith. That's it. Do you understand? He said, if I be lifted up, I would draw all men unto me. Jeremiah understood it. Jeremiah, you're going to go be a mouthpiece. You're going to speak to my people. Oh, no, I ain't either. Oh, yes, you are too. Well, what are you going to do, Jeremiah? I'm going to get married. Oh, you are too. Now what you going to do? Go ahead. I'll give you time. Go on and mow, go up and complain. But by the time I get finished with you, guess what you're going to do? You're going to go. Oh, I got something for you. I'm going to put this word down in you. It's going to be like fire shut up in your bones. I'm going to put so much of this word down in you that you got to speak in order to get a release. Now you can run, but you can't hide. Now try to run from the Holy One of Israel and see what happened. Jeremiah finally said, I surrender all. I'm gone. I can't contend with the Holy One. And then he gave him encouragement. Be not afraid of their faces. That's the reason why Jeremiah didn't want to go, because you are something else. You ought to see some of the damn faces you have when you sitting here listening to this word, thinking that it's a man's word. The arrogance and audacity you have to suffer and contend with the Holy One of Israel. You better thank God there was a time he used to wink at your ignorance. We some arrogant people, ain't we? Huh? Stupefied. Dumbified. We are some ate up, destroyed people. I'm telling you, there's something wrong in Israel. As if our disagreement ever mean anything. I said, I already got it covered. Hell had to enlarge in herself. He only need a few anyway. That's all he need. And for you to say, see, that's what Christianity's done. Christianity's done is made you think you can come in, check in your time, you done something for Yah. And Christianity make you think
that the earth and the world and all of y'all's kingdom can't do nothing without you. I'm going to tell you this. Y'all who need a slumber's going to sleep. Right. Now you follow me? He don't care about folks. Folks been going to hell since the beginning of the time. Yes, and there's going to be a whole bunch of them. Yeah, I mean, the prophet said hell had enlarging. Yes, sir. It had a certain capacity. Yes, but because men are so wicked today, amen. It had to get bigger, amen. In order to receive them.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. All right. Great. Amen.
So you keep your attitude. As dumb as you are.
That's right.
How can I say that? Because I used to be dumb too.
Yeah.
It takes a one to know one.
That's right.
Duh, duh.
That's right.
Well, here we go. This is where Galatians comes in. You be hated of all men for his name's sake then, isn't it? Isn't it? Isn't it? You got to get hated for something.
Yeah.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
I mean, if they can kill a man that never committed any sin, then what do you think they're going to do to you?
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. So we got to get it right. We're here to be helpers of your faith. And then the book gives you instructions in how to behave yourself in the household of faith.
Yes, sir.
Yes it does.
It
and in his house of prayer.
Amen. Amen. Yes, sir.
You get it?
Yes, sir.
And once we understand, we can move on.
Yes, sir.
Hmm?
Yes, sir.
So glory to the King.
Glory!
Galatians 5:6 said, if anyone does not stay in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are
burned.
Now notice, the key is stay in him. There it is. If you stay in me, and my words stay in you. Hear that? You had a young man called in on a broadcast last night, Brother Felix, huh? Pastor, why don't people go to sleep? I said, because they got past it in and their relationship with Most High ain't where it should be. And for you to go to sleep on me is something else. Y'all understand, y'all looking at a mild mannered Pastor Dow right now. I used to throw chairs in the congregation. I used to throw water in, man, and you fall asleep on me, boy, I'll give you a bath at morning. Am I telling the truth, old straightway? People took plenty of baths. I used to throw it. You got to revive the dead. And don't y'all think I've always been I have not always been a protector of women. I remember one time I was up preaching in the pulpit, minding my own business, whatever that was. And Brother saying, you know I'm getting ready to go. Yeah. And it was a little small congregation. All of a sudden, I came out of the pulpit, and I looked back there and I said, you've been beating your wife. I went and grabbed that chair, bam, threw it in. I tried to take his head off of that chair. These folks don't believe me. Man, you know what that guy did? He fell on his knees. And he said, God, please forgive me. God, please forgive me.
Come on.
You, oh, yeah, thank you. I thought it had me. I'm calling the law.
Yeah. Yeah.
He wanted to get his heart right. He wasn't hiding.
Yes, sir.
Glory.
Yeah, let me do this. I'm preaching.
Yes, sir.
Mind my own business, whatever it is, preaching. Yes, all of a sudden, he turns around and puts it in my heart. That this man has been beating up on his wife. Yeah. Man, I grabbed that chair. Did I not try to take his head off, Brother Shane? I tried to take his head off of that chair.
Come on.
And my aim was true, too. The wall didn't look good after that.
Come on.
And you're talking about a strong, powerful young Pastor Dow, too, then. There wasn't nothing for me to throw a chair from here to there. And when that guy turned around and hit his knees, you knew y'all hit it. I didn't say Pastor Dow hit it. I said, y'all hit it. You know he hit it then, boy. He hit the knees, boy. He got to repent. What are we supposed to do then? What? Take chair and finish him off? Now, you can't take chair and finish him off, man. He meeting y'all terms. It just then it took y'all using this unorthodox way of throwing furniture. You know like you women do when you get mad at your husbands.
Jezebels. Did I say something wrong?
No,
most of you say, ain't no way I'd ever sit up under that kind of preaching. That's why y'all didn't bring you in.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen. Broke the wall. So if you stay in me, my word stay in you, you shall ask whatever you wish, and it shall be done for you. It is my Father. In this, my Father is esteemed that you bear what? Not be some dead fruit sitting on the pew or sitting on the chair. And you shall be my taught ones. Repentance. Now, I want to tell you something about this falling away thing. Or let's say staying in him. Now, I know that the world got it one way. But y'all has it another. And you need to understand this. Because the only ones that really truly fall away, and I'm going to cover this again, just don't want to let it slip. You see, you have to be in him first before you can fall away. And that's not mental sin. We're talking about keeping the commandments, being filled with his Holy Spirit, walking in obedience. These ones who've actually done the works, they've cast out devils just like the Messiah said that would happen. And then they fall away. He's not talking about these mild profession people who ain't never been in it because they put their mind to it. He's talking about those who lived it. You can't fall away from something you ain't never been in. Is that right? So falling away first, here we go. Hey, 2 Thessalonians 2:3, let no one deceive you in any way, because the falling away is to come. What's going to, before all these catastrophes, for all these pestilence, earthquakes, and everything else, wars and rumors of wars, everything else, guess what? There's got to be even greater purging of the house. Now, y'all listening to me, Israel? There has to be a greater purging of the house. Because in a great house, there are vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. And the sole purpose of this falling away is just to keep the vessels of honor. Y'all getting this?
Yes, sir.
Now, let's under that light right there, let no one deceive you in any way, because the falling away is to come. Look at this. And the man of lawlessness, the Bible called it sin. But this is a man of what? Lawlessness. Because sin is the transgression of the
law.
So we're going to go back to Torah, get it concrete. All right? The one who practices lawlessness, does lawlessness, and teach lawlessness. All right? Is to be revealed the son of destruction. All right? Because of the what? Falling away first. Falling away. Greek. 646. Apostasy. Apostasia. Look at this. A defection from truth. So, watch this. This don't apply to Christians. Are you understanding?
Yes,
this is talking about those who have the understanding you have.
Yes, sir.
It's talking about Israelites.
Yes,
it's not talking about Christians, Catholics. No, it ain't. People in Muslim, Islam, Buddha, all these religions, it ain't talking to none of them people. It's talking to people like you. This is written to people like you who know. So, watch this. There must first be a falling away even greater amongst us. Y'all hearing that, Israel? Y'all hearing that on the other side of that camera, hard hat? Some of you are sitting there, but some of you got to go before the kingdom comes.
Come on.
Are y'all listening to this?
Yes, sir.
Because you got to be into something before you can fall away from something.
Yes.
And we're talking about falling away from the faith.
Yes, sir.
So some of you keep being presumptuous. Keep acting arrogantly and being daring. Keep on. You're only manifesting yourself of the ones that have to go. So wipe out to make yourself feel better that it's talking about everybody else. Israel, no, it's talking about us. And some of you have got to go before the king comes. So much, we got to go save the whole world. Because he ain't trying to save the whole world. He come to save his people from their sins, from their lawlessness. Let's get it right. So it's got to be a defection from truth, properly stated apostasy, falling away or forsaken. This is not talking about mouth-professing so-called believers who do not keep the commandments. You cannot fall away from something that you've never had. It's written to those who have repented of their sins, been baptized in water, those who have been baptized in baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking with tongues, the Spirit of Yah gave the utterance, those who have kept the commandments, cast out demons. This is a warning to those who have experienced all of these since being converted from the world. See, we've been taught by many philosophies to blame shift. We've been taught that we're the cream of the crop. We sit here and we holy and set apart and stuff, and we've already arrived. And see, where you get the attitude from? You get it from Christianity. That's why I keep telling you, that's the residue of you that's got to get out of you. You got to get out of you unless you be proud, unless you be arrogant. Are you following me? Oh, yeah. And you'll think yourself something when you're nothing. See, we lost the fear of Yah. Amen. Because we think, Christianity makes us think we can say a few words and all of a sudden we're in the kingdom.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we go and behave arrogantly. We live arrogantly. Yeah, we are. We're proud.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we are.
Oh, yeah.
And don't know nothing. And they made you to think that Yah needs you.
Yeah.
I got some news for you. Yah don't need you. You need him.
Yes, sir. Amen. Hallelujah.
And guess what? He don't care if you don't come.
That's right.
He said, come unto me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Yes, sir.
I ain't talking about me. I'm just using that as an expression. Come to him. He said, come. Uh-oh, you better get it right.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, man, what a job they have done on us.
Yes,
how many times you went around so-called witnessing?
Yeah.
Huh? Badgering people half to death.
Right.
Making them all uncomfortable.
Because
you trying to get more tithe payers in the church for the bishop.
Yes, sir.
Dumb dumb.
Right.
There you are.
Yeah.
They get you out there. You sing these songs. I'm on the battlefield for my Yah. Yeah. Well, I'm on the battlefield for my Yah. Come on, Elder. You know what I'm singing. Hey, I promise him that I'm going to serve him till I die. Elder Donnie got it, boy. Y'all ain't hearing it. A battlefield for my Yah. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Come on.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah.
And you thought you was on the battlefield for Yah. You was on the battlefield of the First Missionary Baptist Church.
Yes, sir.
On a battlefield with nobody.
That's right.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Why come y'all get the Holy Ghost and do it again?
Come on,
oh, hallelujah. We got to get this thing right. Because
yes,
once you get it right, then you'll find out you're in need of him.
Yes,
and he's not in need of you.
No.
Hmm? Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, if you continue with this kind of attitude, the way you were, you'll never have any fear. You'll relax his laws. You'll relax his word. Yeah, you will.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? You'll be like, okay, man, I understand it's a good thing to obey him, but we really ain't got to. Because of grace. See, they done tore you up. I told somebody the other day, I said, go look at my teaching on grace. It's going to rip apart everything you thought you believed to be true. Ooh-wee. Ain't y'all good? And the one thing we seen of Yah, he don't respect the persons. He put it on Moses, put it on David. Oh yeah. And these people gonna be in the kingdom. Now if he gonna put it on them, then guess what? You better wake up, Israel. You had better wake up. It's an honor if your name is written down. Yes, it is. So this is a warning to those who have experienced all these since being converted from the world. Salvation is no plaything, especially if you have tasted a Shemaim. That means the heavenly gifts. Verse 4, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called Elohim or God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as Elohim in the dwelling place of Elohim. We know it to be the temple, right?
Yes,
somebody say, my body's the temple.
My body's the temple.
Of the Holy Spirit. Are you following?
Yes,
see, so guess what? The devil want to set up residence in your body.
Right.
In your temple. You looking for some third temple for some anti-Messiah because these bootlickers tell you something and they advertise you to death and put on music. Ooh, 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 get you all mesmerized.
Right.
Lie to you about false prophecies and everything else and just to get another Federal Reserve note out of your pocket.
Yeah.
The red heifer. The third temple. I'm a student of the word. And I can't find no damn third temple.
Right.
I can't find it nowhere. And see, but when you have been used to and conditioned to believing lies all your life, it don't mean nothing when people advertise you something.
Yeah.
It's all about talent. And off you go. Off you go. And then they have conditioned you so good that when somebody comes in the vein of an Israelite, cry aloud and spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. I was like, look what's wrong with them. Look at them. Why is he so angry? Why is he so mad? You can't even receive the man of God here because they have massaged your head. False teaching. False doctrine. Yeah. Christianity. They done tow you up. Somebody come in a vein of truth. What's wrong with you? Start speaking in tongues then. Can't even hear the ones you should hear. I'm unconcerned because I'm already saved. If I can use them terms. My name's already written down. My place in the turn is already secure. I ain't got not one doubt in the world. None whatsoever at all. And you think about it. Boy, somebody talk the way I talk. He got to know something. He got no something and no somebody. Did Moses run around biting his finger to the cliff? I wonder if I'm going to get in or not. Or David, right?
Nah.
You learn that behavior from that fire escape religion.
Right.
I ain't trying to be saved. I am saved from my sins. I don't go live in sin. Now you have a definition of sin, he has one of sin, and I'm more concerned about his and not your book of the law. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory to the King. Maybe I'll get a better response than this when I get to Wilmington, North Carolina. I don't know. They may want to stone me by the time I get going down there. You want to videotape me being stoned, brother?
Not that part.
Brother Darryl, gee. He said, did y'all hear him say somebody better videotape this? Gee. Brother Darryl. Oh, man. So he said, yeah, somebody ought to videotape it. God, mercy.
Oh,
We ain't going to edit it out either. You been caught. So the dwelling place is you. Satan is still vying. He don't care if you've been converted. He don't care if you've been transformed. He don't care about it. He don't care if the Ruah's in you. He still is seeking to get into the what? The temple. What did Ezekiel say? Huh? He said, hey, son of man, come on up here. Let me show you even greater abominations that these people do.
Right.
He said, man, they come out of the temple. They turn their backs towards the temple and they worship the sun.
Yeah.
And not only that, they even got their gods in the walls of the temple.
Come on.
Don't some of you still got some of your Christian gods in that body? In that spirit of yours, which is the Holy Spirit?
Bring it out.
Don't you?
Preach.
Yes, sir.
Y'all ain't putting up with no coexistence. He's a jealous Elohim. Hallelujah. Y'all begin to understand this.
Yes,
so stop with the loop in the fairy tales, trying to confuse the thing and point the finger to everybody else, making you think you've arrived.
Right.
You keep doing like that, you'll be like a lot of these dead heads and you'll stop striving.
Yes.
So he sits as Elohim in a dwelling place, Elohim showing that he himself is what? Elohim. And that's why a lot of these deceived people saying, no, I know Elohim too. No, you don't. No, you don't. The Apostle Saul is not talking about people who forsake going to church or so-called church. This has nothing to do with abandoning religious cultures and activities. The Greek word apostasia means a departure from truth, meaning a defection from or the forsaken of truth. You understand? You don't like people who leave this ministry. You mean tell me he brought you all this point in your life to get you to the point to where, hey, people pray, show me y'all. Preachers, show me his people. And then you get him, you get showed.
Yes, sir.
You find out, yeah, the way is straight. And the road is narrow. And few that do be that find it. You all happy when you first came.
Amen.
Didn't have no enduring substance, though.
Because
you thought that he was playing games. Because you bought that same old mindset from Christianity.
Yeah.
You know, you can vagabond. I told you, this is the last state. That's what Bishop Banks said years ago. This is the last state before the pit.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Before the lake. He said, because you can say that, you know, I've been out there and this, I've been out there, this, but you ain't going to do that here. That's what Bishop Banks said. You ain't going to do that here. We're not in this playing games, toying around with the soul. I bring 10:24, that's Hebrews 10:24. And let us be concerned for one another. Let us do what? Let us fight one another.
Yes,
let us be envious of one another.
Yes,
let us hate one another.
Yes,
let us war and fight with each other.
Yes,
let us be jealous of each other.
Yes,
so let us be concerned for one another in order to stir up love and good what? So when you really truly are concerned about somebody, look what attitude would take place. You will stir up. You would inspire people to love, and not only love, but they'll want to do good. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the habit of some. Is there not some that have been here and now they're forsaking the assembly? Huh? I told you, I got a hallmark saying. I'll tell you what. If you're doing this, walking holier, more closer to the Father than we are, or you find a place that is doing that, please let us know.
Right.
I mean, after all, we did put up with you.
Yes, sir.
So let us know if there's somebody out there that's striving harder, more holy,
right,
so that we can do it too.
Because
we want to get to the kingdom.
Yeah.
And surely you can't be that bitter against me that you hate me that bad that you're not going to let me come. See, the truth is, you just don't want me in your presence.
Come on, amen.
Yeah, right. They don't want you in their presence.
That's
what it is. Let brotherly love continue. Isn't that something? Well, isn't that something? I mean, after all, I did afford you a few years of putting up with you. Well, Pastor Dow, you putting up with us. You better believe it.
Come on.
You better believe it.
When you armed with all the knowledge I got and I see where you come from, I'm the one that's charged to have wisdom to deal with you. Did I say something wrong?
Nope.
And if you going to something greater, don't we deserve the right to know too? I mean, after all, we want to be saved. In other words, they ain't going to nothing better. There's only one other place to go. Back. And if any man put his hand to the plow and he looks back, he's not fit for the kingdom of Yah. See, it'd be one thing if we was like some of these Israelites you see on YouTube and these other people and stuff still stuck off in the cities and carrying on, so-called preaching to how dirty and filthy the world is, and they hanging around all that filth. But we live a set apart life. I can show you a goat, a chicken, and a cow. Right now. I can show you a garden. Country. Countryside. Yeah, coming out from among them. Being set apart, separate. Touching not the unclean thing. Ain't no swine on our land. Ain't not one swine on our land. And anytime those terrorist rabbits come, they get it right between the crosshairs. Uh-oh. Ought to give us credit for something. At least make an attempt. You know right? So, let me tell you something. This is, King James says, this is a manner. It says, habit or something. This has become a mannerism of people. It's telling us don't forsake the assembling of ourselves together. People don't even feel like they even have to assemble no more on the Sabbath.
Amen. Amen.
Don't tell me you, yourself, and your family is all separate. No, no, no. You are one.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are one. As the habit of some, but encouraging. And so much the more as you see the day, notice, this talking about judgment coming near. One of our biggest fears are those of you who refuse to change your attitude from a Christian mindset to being a true Israelite. Because look, Jesus did not say that Nathanael was a Christian. Not indeed, in whom there's no guile. He said, Jesus said, look, Nathanael, come to him. And said of him, behold and behold and behold and behold and indeed in whom is no God. That Christian stuff didn't come until after they put penmanship over in the book of Acts. And as we grow in his word, each new teaching presented is a test of our belief. Y'all hear that? As we grow, each new teaching that comes to us, because ain't nothing new to him. It's new to us because we're discovering it.
Right.
We're coming upon it. So every single time we hear truth, it's a test to us to how much honor and respect we have for the commandments of the Most High. How much honor and respect we have for his word. Because he ain't asking you or me for our opinion. Matter of fact, he don't care about our opinions. He set this whole cosmos in order and didn't even ask us or even inquire of us what we thought about it.
Right.
He didn't ask Abraham. That's a friend of Yah. Shouldn't he ask Abraham? Didn't even ask him. Abraham wasn't even around. Sin is a pleasure for what the flesh wants. Boy, sure did get quiet in here then, didn't it? Oh, don't get me wrong. Sin feels good. To the flesh it does. And just like a snare. There's some people in tied up and tangled in sin. Woo-hoo! Fun, isn't it? When you first start. Huh? And then like a snare. All of a sudden, I don't want this no more, but it gotcha. Gotcha. Uh-huh. That's how the devil does it. What he does, he snares us with pleasures. Y'all hear that? He snares us with the pleasures of sin. But the pleasure of sin only lasts for how long?
A season.
Then after that, what's that song? Who was that? The piper's calling you to join him. Dear lady, you don't know. What happened? You going blank?
I can't
You want Brother James get up and play it?
No, I'm good. I just
call the You could call it when you was on the other side of the internet. You're sitting right here in front of us, and all of a sudden you're drawing blanks.
It's a transformation.
Could he do it? Could he do it all? Y'all mess. It's a choice to live as an Israelite in obedience to the scriptures. So the question is, what will you choose? Because the same ultimatum that was offered to Joshua way back then, Joshua way back then, choose you this day. Don't you wait till tomorrow. No, you can't do it about yesterday. You're too dumb to make a decision. He said, choose you this day whom you're going to serve. Y'all notice, I don't hardly ever use the word stupid. Stupid is the English word for the word brutish. And the scriptures teach us to not call people stupid. A dull person. I never mind. Anyway, let me get on this thing. All right. Hebrews 11:24. Going back to the King James. By faith, Moshe, when he was come to years, watch this. Mind you, he grew up with all the luxury and all the power of an Egyptian prince in Mizraim. Huh? By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. That's like almost being a son of Warren Buffett. All that money. Everything that he needed at a word. And when he came to the knowledge of the truth, he said, you know what? I am not your son. Of course, you know it's going to turn Papa bitter. Oh, you going to come against me after me raising you? That'd be one thing coming from poor going to riches. But from coming from riches and going to poor and volunteering for it. So if you ain't rich at all, we can't get you to give up nothing.
Right.
Isn't that something? By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of Yah. With the people of
Yah.
Than to enjoy the pleasures of seeing for a season. And your season is your life. That's your season.
Come on.
How are some of you faring now? Especially you folks on the other side of that camera.
Right.
Can you imagine? Now that's a decision. Because he knew what the Hebrews was going through. He didn't do nothing to ease their suffering. Not while he was in the house being a prince. Boy, you people just don't get this stuff, do you? You don't get it, do you? You just don't get it, do you? This man grew up with a silver, gold, emerald spoon in his mouth. That was his people out there that every single day he saw when he was snatching crumbs all the way up to he was a grown man, mighty in valor in wars. He passed by them every single day and never thought one bit about their suffering or the taskmaster's whip on the back of their backs. Didn't trouble him at all. He didn't try to lobby Congress, see if we can get a bill passed to ease the suffering of the Hebrews. And then one day it came into his mind. One day.
Bring it out.
And boy, don't you tell me he didn't sit back and think long and hard. Boy, because he looked at that condition and he is what? Getting ready to go from riches to rags? Woo-wee. And some of you can't give up a damn cigarette. You can't give up drugs. You can't give up whoremongering. You can't give up nothing. And you think you're going to enter into the kingdom of God like hell you are. Your defiled self. I told you, this Christian stuff has been preached to us like a fairy tale. Y'all see what Moses did? I was breaking it down. He had thought about this long and hard. And when it was all said and done, he chose. That means willfully. That's just like Christ when he was birthed, before he even left the eternal, when he came down here, he knew the fate he was going to suffer. He chose. And some of you can't even choose to give up your damn life. What is your life anyway but a vapor, a mist? Here it is gone. You ain't got nothing that's going to echo throughout all eternity without Christ. We had better wake up. Big time. Moses esteemed the reproach of Christ greater riches. Esteeming reproach? Esteeming reproach? Greater riches than the treasures in Egypt? You mean persecutions?
Yes.
Sufferings?
Yes.
No wonder Paul gloried in shipwrecks,
yes, sir,
in perils of countrymen,
yes,
and in perils of brethren,
yes,
in fastings, orphans,
yes,
beatings, and in jails.
Yes, sir.
And as soon as persecution comes your way, first thing you're looking for is relief. These people counted as a badge of honor. What kind of mindset do we have today? What the hell is wrong with us? That's the question that need to be asked.
Right, sir. Sure.
See, you can't believe right if it ain't preached right.
Right.
People done dressed this word up to make you feel better.
Right.
I feel better for the cause of Christ.
Yes,
how about you?
Yes, sir.
Esteeming the approaches Christ greater than riches in greater riches the treasure in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of reward. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. You mean to tell me Moses did not fear Pharaoh? Everybody feared Pharaoh. Everybody did. Moses said, I'm not fearing the wrath of the king. So what did he do? For he endured as seeing him who is invisible. You mean tell me he could see this eternal? This invisible? This most high Yah? Yeah, he feared Yah. That's who he feared. And through faith, he kept the Passover. But today, we wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. A good tidings we bring to you and your King. Then we go from that, when it get nightfall, silent night. Then we have all our feast days, New Year's Day, St. Patrick's Day, Valentine's Day, and then you niggas, you get the shortest history in the month, 28 days.
You get a Black History Month. Out of 12 months in a year, you think you done something, and they give you a month, they tell you it's Black History. When your damn blood has done saw the land here in America, every month is your month of history.
Did
I say something wrong?
No, sir.
And then you get ready to chase an unclean rabbit and eat a bunch of swine and pig to the fertility goddess. Ishtar, Astarte, Easter. In direct opposition of Yah's word. It is an abomination, your hot cross buns. We ain't gonna dress it up. And sprinkle the blood lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. He received a warning. Moses said, you know what? The Most High said, we better put the blood on the doorpost. We better strike it on three sides, because I'm telling you what, if we don't do it, when that death angel come, he ain't discriminating. He ain't playing no games. He will kill us just like he killed Pharaoh's son. And some of you just don't believe that destruction is coming. You don't believe it's coming. Did y'all hear me? When I told you about the Greeks, I told you, I said, them people out there don't believe. I said, they're all rejoicing in the street. Yay, we reject hostility. We reject hostility. Yeah.
Come on.
I'm sitting there going, these people, man, I rejoice with them. Should have did a long time ago, like America.
Yeah.
I said, but boy, you people don't know. Let me hurry and get this video out right here. I know they ain't going to hear it, but let me get it out. And my warning is to where my foot is. It's in this land called America now. You get ready, because when you reject our steward, if you ever get the opportunity to do it, or either they reject it for you. People jumping ship. This country's sinking fast because we don't understand economic policies. We don't understand it. We don't know money in this country. We don't. And either when they pull the plug or you say enough is enough, all you truckers,
yes, sir,
tell the people how much goods and services are going to be on the shelves when they stop running.
Zero.
Zero.
Right.
And since some of you are so foolish and you won't take heed to wise warning, I told you years ago, some of you have been listening to me for a long time, I told you to get out of the debt. I told you to get out of the city. Yes, I did. Yeah, I did. So don't tell me, watch this. All glory to the King, that the Most High Yah is not telling us that the time is near.
Hallelujah.
Because the same instructions that I'm giving, it ain't nothing new.
Amen.
It's the same thing it's been of old.
Amen.
You got to be able to discern the signs of the times. I told you, you better start storing food. Because the amount of debt that we in, we going right back to Mizraim.
Yes,
because when you can't pay, now we want your sons.
Yes,
and we want your daughters. Yeah, we do. And that's how you're going to pay for it.
Yep.
Look at them looking at me.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, all these things was written by him, and this and I learned it so we can stay dumb, dormant, docile, and demoralized, isn't it?
Come on, amen.
So we don't have to pay attention to nothing.
Right. Come on.
Amazing, isn't it? Now who the fool is?
Yes, sir.
Well, that land ain't going to save you. No, it's the ones in charge of the land. He said the angel of the Most High is encamped around about them that fear him.
Hallelujah.
So no, I ain't got nothing to worry about.
That's right.
I ain't got nothing to worry about. If he removes his angels and say they can have it, good, you can have it. Bye, I'm gone. Well, what are you doing? I'm going to the wilderness. Well, where the manna is.
Yes,
yeah, where air conditioning is by day.
Yes,
uh-huh, and warmth of fire by night.
Yes,
can he do it again?
Yes,
can he do it again?
Yes,
yeah, he gonna do it for Israel that's faithful, but you lying deceivers, don't you think you gonna receive anything from the Most High Yah?
Nope.
That's why I keep telling you. He's got to get rid of a bunch of hypocrites from among us.
Yes, sir.
There still must yet be a purging in
Israel, for that day is not going to come except there be a falling away first. And some of you are on your way. Keep turning around to Mosiah. Some of you are well on your way. And Yah know them that are his. We better let these things sink deep down in our hearts. Lest that he be destroyed. Lest he that destroy the firstborn should touch them. Y'all getting that? That's the new mark, sisters. We can use that one or the other. You can stay right there if you want to, because this is going to get better. Brother Saint, get the scripture version of Abarim, chapter 11, verses 32 through 40. Are y'all doing all right?
Yes, sir.
Y'all doing all right? Y'all still love me?
Yes, sir.
I just ask you for your benefit, because you're commanded to love me. I don't care if you love me or not. Just like I'm commanded to love you. You don't care why I love you now. You just make sure I keep the commandments, right?
That's right.
Okay, then. Same for you.
Yes, sir.
Oh, hallelujah. When you get it, Brother Saint, go ahead and read.
And what more shall I say?
Okay, listen.
For the time would fail me to relate of Gideon and Barak and Shimshon and Yephthah and also of David and Shemuel and Nibram.
Man, these are some faithful men,
yes, sir,
to be included in the faith chapter.
Yeah.
Now, wait. And Yephthah, born of a concubine. You know what I mean? Brothers kicked him out of the house, kind of like they did yourself. Couldn't handle the pressure that was on him. Went to the land, told, said, hey, Jephthah, guess what, man? If you come, we'll make you captain over us, king over us. Oh, really? Nah, I tell you what, I ain't going to come unless that happens. And I'm going to be the ruler. I'm going to help you take care of the enemy, but I'm ruling the house.
Right.
Now, guess who the Israelite now? These folks ain't ready. They ain't ready. I don't blame them for practicing collusion. Read on, Brother Saint.
Who through belief overcame reigns, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became mighty in battle, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection.
Ooh.
And others were tortured, not accepting release.
Oh, now wait a minute. We need to put emphasis on that. All we read was all these people that escaped by the hand of Yah many persecutions. Yeah, he did. But then it also said, and others were tortured. See, you don't know what your lot really truly is. You need to have your heart prepared either way. Y'all hear me? Huh? Oh, we all talk tough about, oh, I'll go to the lion's den until that big old cave open up. And you see them 400-500-pound lions looking at you roaring. See, you people just think that all they did was just they put them in it. And y'all deliver them. That don't mean that this may be your lot. Your lot may be. Read that part again, Brother Saint, about others did what?
And others were tortured.
Others were what?
Tortured.
Others were what?
Tortured.
Don't you think that your lot is just the angel of the Lord? He gonna come and get me. Was Christ tortured?
Yes, sir.
How about Shimon Kepler?
Yes.
Majority emissaries, wasn't he?
Yes.
You better arm yourself.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. You better arm yourself.
Yes, sir.
You better arm yourself. Because not only did these guys preach tough, talk tough, and live tough, they died tough.
Yes, sir.
You better get it through your head. You're going to find out who you're serving then, ain't you?
Yes,
see, here's the secret. If you can't serve him with fervency and zeal and vigor when it's easy,
yeah,
what do you think they're going to do when they bring the torture out on you and the persecutions and just at the mere threat of it? I mean, you're already submitting to the weakness of the dictates and mandates of the flesh, and you ain't standing on nothing. All of a sudden, you're going to be able to manufacture some courage?
Right.
And you ain't living nothing now?
No.
You have deceived yourself.
Yep.
Mm-mm-mm. Read on, Brother Shane.
Not accepting release to obtain a better resurrection.
Oh, you hear that? They wasn't going to accept and deliverance from this world system. They were going to go ahead and go to that death just so they can have a better resurrection. Where are the mothers at today that will say to their son, son, prepare yourself for a good death. Because before we yield to these goyims and stuff, we going to die.
That's right.
Huh? Don't worry about what they're going to. I know what they're going to do. They're going to bring you before me and torture you in front of me.
Yep.
Huh? And don't worry about it. You go ahead and go. Go with a good prize.
That's right.
Waiting on you.
Yes, sir.
Don't you dare compromise one bit. Don't worry about mama.
That's right.
Mama going to be here encouraging you.
That's right.
After you die, next, get him too. Yeah, come on. Because you ain't going to get me. I ain't compromised. You ever heard of a woman like that before?
Yes, sir.
Huh? You ever heard of a woman? Didn't we read about a woman like that before?
Yes, sir.
Huh? Can you, have you thought about your sons?
Come on, amen.
Mama? Have you? Huh, that's one thing to say it, but it's another thing to do it.
Right.
You better get your heart right. See, that account was used for mothers because mothers are attached, really attached. Daddies are attached too, but daddies, they'll go to war. They'll bring their sons with them to war.
Come on,
they will. You die, good death, son. Pull them off.
That's right.
That's the way pops think. And if pop get killed before son, the pop say, get up off me and go finish.
Right.
You been finished.
That's right.
Huh? But dad, son, grab your stuff by your boot straps. Get out there.
Come on. Yes, sir.
That's real. Man, you people.
Yeah.
Man, I tell you what. See the difference? Israel, we better get our minds right.
Yes, sir.
We better stop with these base thoughts. I'm telling you, we had better start really, truly looking in the deepness and the crevices of our hearts.
Yeah.
We had better get down in there. And we better get down there real thick and real deep, real fast. Before, because persecution is promised.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Persecution is promised to Israelites.
Yes,
it is, too.
Yes,
He's warning us. Oh, hallelujah. The world, we're the sky on the earth. We're ambassadors of the kingdom of God. They don't care nothing about us. Not one bit. Read on, Brother Shane.
And others had trial of mockings.
They mocked them in trials. Come on.
And floggings and more of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were tried. They were sawn in two. They were slain with a sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins.
That's destitute right there. That's being destitute. Come on.
Being in need, afflicted, mistreated. Of whom the world was not worthy.
What?
The world.
What?
The world was not worthy.
The world was not what?
Worthy.
The world is not even worthy of the presence of these kind of Israelites. Man. Read on.
Wandering in deserts and mountains and caves and holes of the earth.
And then some of you, when it comes time, you go sleep in a tent. You can't sleep in a tent. We have gods and then we have tabernacles and boy, you complain about sleeping in a tent and you think you're going to be able to run wander through a desert. You're going to be able to go in a cave. You're going to find a hole to sleep in. Let me tell you something. America has made you a bunch of sissies. You're a bunch of soft people. That's exactly what you are. Here you are. A lot of this stuff, just even when I was U.S. Army Airborne, I've already experienced that. Because in 82nd, man, you don't get no tent when you go to the field. No way, shape, as a form, ain't no tents. Your tent is that sky. Your canopy is a tree. That's it. You got to come out there with the deuce and have hump V. They're going to put up a GP medium for you. Put a pot belly stove up in the cellar. Run you some electricity by the generator. And you think you in the field roughing it. Man. I told y'all about when I was in Honduras, when I woke up, what happened? I was covered with scorpions. I had scorpions all over me, man. At first, I thought it was going to bite and sting the mess. They didn't fool with us just like ants don't fool with you too much. Let's say them little red fire ants, boy. Them little boogers, boy. They'll see you, man. They just get the town on you, boy. They just start biting for no reason at all.
Yes, sir.
Them boogers get after you. And it wasn't. They told them paratroopers, they said, look here. Don't nobody take the scorpions from his land back to division. Of course, when you tell somebody don't do something, what are they going to do? They just start biting the hell out of them until they got back to the division. The scorpions even knew that they wasn't in their land, so they started biting them. Started stinging the fire out of them. They say, you know, that sick call is full. I'm telling you. Them folks crazy. You ain't going to tell no paratrooper that anyway, because he about to have stupid as crap anyway. Why would somebody want to jump out of an airplane? Repel out of a helicopter? For what? Didn't he make us earth creatures? Ah, never mind. Come on, bro, say read.
And having obtained witness through the belief, all these did not receive the promise.
Look at that. Can you imagine going through all that and you did not receive the promise in this lifetime? You had faith believing that the promise was coming. You had hope believing that the promise was on its way, and you didn't receive it. Can you believe it? So they died having not received the promise. Most of you faint in a day of adversity. As soon as it come up on you, you get challenged by it, you done. You gone. Ah! Ah! Read on.
Elohim having provided what is better for us,
mm-hmm.
that they should not be made perfect apart from us.
Now, isn't that amazing? They went through all that, and yet and still, they can't be complete. They cannot be perfect until we have finished our testimony. And these are people of like passion. They ain't no superman, superwoman. They are people just like us. It's just that they had a greater level of belief. What I keep pushing. Can't y'all tell that I spiritually I just push y'all?
Oh, yeah.
Your flesh be and I mean your flesh be and I go your flesh be and I be all y'all know is what's happening. Yeah, you do. Hardheads. Yes, you do.
Yes, sir.
Well, I don't like you calling us hardhead. Okay, what's your head then?
Hard.
No, it's okay if you say it though, right? You finished, bro, saying? The sad part about today is Christianity is the religion of Satan, the strong delusion the Bible warns us about. Hebrews 11, brother Shane, read verses 6 through 16. I'll read it. Look what it says. But without belief, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to Elohim has to believe that he is. And he is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. Do you want the reason why many of you are not receiving no rewards? Because you don't earnestly seek him. No, you don't. In the King James, it says diligently.
Yeah, right.
You too busy going to sleep.
Yeah, right. Amen. Come on.
Just got finished sleeping 8 to 10 hours, and then you come here to sleep another hour. A little slumber, a little sleep, a little folding other hands, wipe another mouth, get it all in, right? He said, he is a rewarder of them who earnestly seek him. Now, what we have to do, since we're going to prove all things, we need to ask ourselves a question. Do I earnestly seek him? Answer it for yourself. Ha ha. By belief, Noah, being warned of what was yet unseen, having feared, prepared an ark to save his household through the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to belief. And by belief, Abraham, obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he was about to receive as an inheritance. Abraham was told to come out of Ur, my people. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By belief, he sojourned in the land of promise as a stranger, dwelling in the tents of Yitzhak and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking for the city having foundations. You think he was looking for this city on his earth? Oh boy, that's an area we need to touch on. See, you think that Abraham was going to look at some glorious city like Dubai. That's what you're thinking. No, Abraham was a sojourner. Yeah, he was. A stranger and a pilgrim in this land. Just passing through. He left his father's house on a journey in this life to get to the city who builder and maker is Yah. It was his journey that was going to take him to the city. It wasn't no earthly city he was looking for. He believed in him who is invisible. Having seen while not yet seen. For he was looking for the city and foundation who built and maker was Elohim. By belief also Sarah herself was enabled to conceive seed. And she bore a child when she was past the normal age. 99 years old? 90 years old? Can you imagine that? That's like Mother Beasley. Mother Beasley. And Mother Beasley is a unique woman. Every time Mother Beasley come here, she takes a long, hard look at my motorcycle. She's 92 years old, I think. And Pastor, you pray for me, because if I didn't slip and mess my hip up, I wouldn't have this walker, but you pray for me. I want you to pray for me right now so we can go for a ride on that motorcycle. She's 92 years old and been in holiness all her life, majority of her life. She ain't know nothing about no pastor die. One day, Brother Jermaine was sitting about listening to the sermon. She was walking by. She's about 88 years old then. She walked by and she goes, "That's truth right there. Who is that?" Been following and supporting ever since. Told him. And at 92 years old, she shows up on average 3 to 4 times down here every year. How many hour drive is it from where Brother Jermaine is at? A 6 hour drive. She'll get in that vehicle and drive all the way down here, ride all the way down here. Be with the saints of the Most High Yah. We can only hope that if the Father allots us that much time left, which I don't think it is, but if he does, we can be in the same mind, health, and condition as this woman. That's true. Some of us ain't looking too good at all. We're not even going to make half of that. Some of us ain't going to make three quarters of that with the way we so-called take care of ourselves. Mother Beasley is somebody to be envied in this generation. There are people in the 70s plugged up to vampire machines. They don't know if they coming or going. Drooling at the mouth, taking every drug known to man, and Mother Beasley still trekking. What? Passover, let's go. Pentecost, let's go. Go to visit, let's go. Every time she see me, she go, "Woo, boy, you sure are a handsome man." I'll be doing it. She does. Look at Sister Carol and say, "Boy, if I was younger." What's wrong with you people? You so holy you ain't no damn good? This old woman trying to minister to y'all ragheads. Get your mind screwed on right. You ain't getting nothing over on either. Oh, no, you ain't. She a keen 92-year-old. Oh, yeah. She already know about you as soon as you walk up to her. No wonder some of you stay away. I stay away, too, if I was wicked. Because the wicked flee with no man pursue her. But the righteous are as bold as a lion. Let me go ahead and get back on this real quick before we offend somebody. All right? And I believe also Sarah herself was unable to conceive seed. She bore a child when she was past the normal age because she deemed him trustworthy who had promised. And so from one and him, so good as dead, were born a numerous as the stars of heaven and countless as the sands of the sands which is by the seashore. In belief, all these died having not received the promise. Because their focus was on the kingdom. But seeing them from a distance, they seen it. Can you see the kingdom? From a distance? I'm going to tell you right now, I definitely ain't here looking for no kingdom right now in this particular age of time. I'm not doing and working my fingers to the bone, brothers working the way they are, because we looking for a kingdom. No, we ain't either. We doing this because we already are going to obtain the kingdom. But we do what we do because we can see the kingdom afar off. See, when you wake up every morning and see the inspiration of the Most High, knowing that the King is coming, man, and the kingdom coming with it, man, that changes everything about your outlook on life. You don't mind getting out there, getting in the sun and sweating, hammering a few nails, shoveling some manure. Oh, yeah, going getting build material, cooking and weeding and picking. Man, you do it with a smile on your face. You ain't got to be told, get to the garden. You show up because you're looking for the kingdom. You preparing yourself now for the kingdom to come. Yes, you ain't got to be told, get out of bed.
Right.
Your attitude is just different.
Yes,
your outlook on life is different.
Yes,
you view things differently.
Yes,
you're inspired. You're under the inspiration and unction of the Most High Yah.
Yes,
you understand that whatever you do now is going to echo throughout all of eternity, and you're going to inherit the kingdom. See, that's the attitude, the reason why you see some of us Israelites work so hard. We're preparing ourselves for the kingdom. Because those of us who work hard now, in the kingdom, we're going to rule. I'm telling you, they're going to carry me around. I'm having me a little fan. They're going to look as an Israelite servant of the Most High Yah, who when he was on earth, he obeyed Yah. Oh, hallelujah. I'm telling him, hey, get out there and dance them grapes into some wine for me. I'm going to have me a wine vat funneled while I'm laying down.
Y'all people don't know about the kingdom. You people don't know about. They don't. You didn't know that y'all promised you servants in the kingdom?
Yes, sir.
You didn't know that?
Yes, sir.
But he ain't going to give them to you if you ain't found faithful now.
Right. Yes, sir.
Nah, you can't be found faithful now. You ain't going to rule.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Right.
See, you still got Christianity in you.
Yeah.
You don't know. You don't know. Oh, mercy. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm not going to spend the rest of the day trying to teach you what the kingdom is all about. We're going to stay the course right here where we're at. In belief, all these guys have not received the promise, but seeing them from a distance, welcome and embrace them and confess that they were aliens and strangers on the earth. For those who speak this way, make it clear that they seek a fatherland. And yet, if they had indeed kept remembering that place from which they had come out, they would have had a chance to return. But now, they long for a better place, that is, a heavenly. Therefore, Elohim is not ashamed to be called their Elohim, for he has prepared a city for them. See, what happens is, you get people that come this way, they say, the way is too straight. The way is too narrow. And they get offended because of the way.
Amen.
That's what they do. And then they turn around, you know what? The leeks and garlic wasn't that bad. See, but we don't say it today. What we do is we say, man, you know, living the way we used to live wasn't that bad. Mm-hmm. That old man starts reconsidering. Uh-huh. And then, of course, you know, you have to make somebody evil, make somebody bad, so to make your spirit a whole lot more comfortable going back. You know what I mean? You got to justify yourself somehow, because you just ain't going to be going back to going back. You got to talk about somebody.
Yes, sir. Right.
You got to point out all their shortcomings and faults from your point of view and perspective. You got to get people that ally with you. Yeah, so you can feel comfortable going back, not knowing that the very same people who you used to preach to about your conversion and your walk, when you get back there, oh, they're going to pat you on the back. But soon you leave out of their presence. See, I told you that fool was in a fairy tale make-believe. Yep. He didn't believe nothing.
Yep.
And then when you come back around, how you doing, cheese?
Yep. Come on.
And guess what? If there was an opportunity for them to actually come into this walking way and make it to the kingdom, oh, you all but solidify their foundation. Huh? By your hypocritical, two-faced way of walking. Huh? They ain't gonna believe nothing. You didn't believe it, so why should they believe it?
That's right.
You ain't convinced? Why should they be convinced?
Yes, sir.
You know the book talks like this.
Yes,
you just don't read it that way.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Mm-mm-mm. Boy, the Most High, he preaching today.
Yes,
Spirit of truth is having his way.
Yes,
have your way, Father.
Hallelujah.
From the scripture, 2 Corinthians 16. And what union? Have the dwelling place of Elohim with idols, for ye are the dwelling place of the living Elohim. As Elohim have said, what did he say? Notice. We don't get no thus said the Lord this time. But we are getting that Yah have said. This is what Paul's saying. You getting it? He's saying, but Yah have said, I shall dwell in them and walk among them. And I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Huh? Therefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith Yahweh. Notice, Paul didn't say this. He said, Elohim said this. I said, Paul didn't say this. Let's go back and look at it again, because you're going to miss it. He said, Elohim has said, I shall dwell in them and walk among them, and I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith Yahweh, and do not touch what is unclean, and I shall receive you, and I shall be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters to me, saith Yahweh the Almighty. Paul didn't say that. Yah said that. And we'll give you the precept on it, all right? Depart ye, touch not the unclean thing. Go ye out of the midst of her, and earth, and be ye clean. Away, away. You know, we got all kinds of songs down in here. There's a lot of songs in here. Anyway, so look what he said. Depart ye, go out from thence, touch no unclean thing. Go ye out of the midst of her and be clean that bear the vessels of Yah. Key word. Vessels of Yah, key word. Look at this. For ye shall not go out with haste, nor go by flight. For Yahweh will go before you, and your Elohim of Israel will be your reward. He also said in Jeremiah, he also said in Ezekiel, he also said in Hebrews. Who or what are these vessels of Yahweh? 1 Thessalonians 4:1 from the King James. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by Yahshua, that as ye have received of us, how ye ought to what?
Walk.
Don't y'all receive of us how you ought to walk?
Yes, sir.
You people didn't know how to walk until y'all came and around the ministry straightway. We're teaching you how to walk.
Yes,
yeah, receive us how to walk and to please. So ye would abound more and more, for ye know what commandments we gave you by Yahshua. Look at this. For this is the will of Yah. Even your sanctification, your set apartness. That ye should abstain from whoring. And that every one of you should know how to possess his
vessel.
Say a word again.
Vessel.
In what? Sanctification and honor. What? 1 Corinthians 6:19. Know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which ye have of Yahweh? And you are not your own. You better be careful how you possess this vessel, this temple. For you are bought with a price. Somebody say, I'm a slave.
I'm a
bond servant.
Bond.
You better start acting like you didn't act like, instead of acting like you some type of free Egyptian.
Yes, sir. Come on. Yes, sir.
Therefore, glorify Yahweh in your body and in your spirit, which are Yah's. 2 Timothy 2:19. Nevertheless, the foundation of Yah stand assured, having this seal. Yahshua knoweth them that are his. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. You name his name, you better quit being lawless. You better depart from it. But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and earth. In a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and, but also of wood and some too. And some too. If a man therefore purge himself from these. You mean tell me you got to work out your salvation?
Yes, sir.
Huh? You mean tell me you got to do something about your spirit and your body?
Yes.
You mean tell me you got to sanctify yourself?
Yes.
You mean tell me I pray that your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless until the coming of the Most High?
Yes, sir.
If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel of?
Uh-huh.
There's that word vessel again, isn't it? Sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace. Whoa, 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 whoa. You mean tell me we supposed to follow after what?
Righteousness.
And?
Faith.
And what?
Charity.
Which is what?
Love.
Love and what?
Peace.
That's what we follow short at.
Yeah.
With them that call on Yahshua out of a what? And I heard Revelation 18:4 says, another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not a partaker of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. America is a land of sin against Yahweh. Huh? Ezekiel 14:12. The word of Yahweh came again to me saying, son of man, when a land sinneth against me by trespassing grievously, then I will stretch out my hand upon it, and I will break the staff of the bread thereof, and I will send famine upon it, and I will cut off man and beast from it. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their, how are they going to deliver their souls? How are these three going to deliver their souls? Save Yahweh Elohim. Now I got a question for you. Do you think he's talking about Noah, Daniel, and Job? Noah, Daniel, and Job is gone. They've been gone. He's trying to give you three holy men that you can actually look to so you can understand the way you need to be.
Right.
He's telling you about how bad it's going to be and what these righteous men would do if they were in the same generation, in the same conditions, faced with the same world.
Yes.
He said that they wouldn't deliver, but they would only deliver their own soul by their own righteousness, meaning they would keep the law. They'll deliver their what? Own souls. By their what?
Righteousness.
If I cause noise and beasts to pass through the land, and they spoil it so that it be desolate, that no man may pass through because of the beast. Man, this is a lot of plagues coming upon the land, right? Though these three men were in it, as I live, said Yahweh, Elohim, they shall deliver neither what? Everybody want to save their wicked son, don't you? Huh? He said these three righteous men wouldn't even deliver what? Son or what? Or daughters. But they shall be delivered by the land. But the land shall be what? Now, wait a minute. You mean 73 righteous men? They love their family just as much as you did. But they say, you know what? I wouldn't even deliver them. No son, nor daughter. Neither one of them. Huh? Or if I bring a sword upon the land and say, sword, go through the land, so that I cut off man and beast from it. Though these three men were in it, as I live, saith Yahweh Elohim, they shall deliver neither what? Sons nor daughters, but they shall say, they shall be delivered themselves. Or if I send pestilence into the land, you know, y'all keep increasing this. Huh? You seeing that in between all this? Now, if he says it, it's one thing if he says it twice. He in the third and fourth time now. You think you can get this through that concrete granite head you got? Huh? Do you think so? It can penetrate. Or if I send pestilence into the land and pour out my fury upon it in blood and cut it off and cut off from it man and beast. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith Yahweh Elohim, they shall deliver neither what? Son nor daughter. They shall but deliver their own souls by their what? Don't you expect your sons and daughters to do right? You better save yourself. That's what you better get through your thick head. All of our brothers and sisters understood this at the time when Pentecost was here. And they had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:40 says, and with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. It ain't nothing new. Nothing new at all. This is our reason of scripture. And with many other words, he earnestly witnessed and urged them, saying, be saved from this crooked generation. Are we not in a crooked generation? Do we not live in a time where they call good evil and evil good? That they call right wrong and wrong right? Do we not live that now? You know we're in a crooked generation. When you can see stuff like this, you know we live in a wicked, crooked generation. And the time is even at the door. You know we live in a crooked generation. We can see an abomination like this, and then people will sit up there and put it all over the news media and stuff. And you see the Supreme Court pass laws in this land that the Torah condemns to death. You know we live in a crooked generation. You better come out of her, my people. You better come out, because if you don't, all of a sudden your heart is going to gather a little fondness for them. All of a sudden you're going to judge Elohim as being irrational. You're going to call him a cruel God. That's why you better come out in order to preserve some sanity. Come out of her, my people. This is a good word. Hallelujah. We bless the Father. I can only pray that these sins will sink deep down in our hearts and that you won't let them slip. Because the spirit of compromise is all through the air. All through the air. Yes, it is too.
Yes, it is. It's trying to get you to relax Yah's laws so that you don't have any conviction no more. You know, it's pretty bad that when we see sin no more, that we don't look at it as a detestable thing any longer. There's something wrong with us. There's something greatly wrong with us when sin no longer is an abomination to us. When we can turn our head at it, just like we can see somebody living holy and accept it, then we accept sin on the same level of conditions. There is something seriously wrong. And I'm telling you, Israel, you want to preserve yourself, not only you come out, but you will stay out. And you will keep his word in you, and it will abide in you, so there will be no variance of turning with you at all. Y'all understand? Hallelujah. Glory to the King.
Glory.
Let us stand, Israel. Hallelujah. Abba, y'all, we do thank you for all things. We pray this saying sink deep down in our hearts in the magnificent, mighty name of Yahshua HaMashiach. Amen. Glory to the King.
Glory.
Shabbat shalom. King coming.